Section 8 of the South Pole. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Scott Carpenter. The South Pole by Roald Amundsen. Translation by A. G. Carter. Section 8, Volume 1, Chapter 3. On the Way to the South, Part 2. We had been lucky with wind and weather at the commencement of our Atlantic cruise in the early summer. This time we were, if possible, even more favored. It was perfectly calm when we sailed, and the North Sea lay perfectly calm for several days after. What we had to do now was to become familiar with and used to all these dogs, and this was enormously facilitated by the fact that for the first week we experienced nothing but fine weather. Before we sailed, there was no lack of all kinds of prophecies of the evil that would befall us with our dogs. We heard a number of these predictions. Presumably a great many more were whispered about, but did not reach our ears. The unfortunate beasts were to fare terribly badly. The heat of the tropics would make short work of the greater part of them. If any were left, they would have but a miserable respite before being washed overboard or drowned in the seas that would come on deck in the west wind belt. To keep them alive with a few bits of dried fish was an impossibility, etc. As everyone knows, all these predictions were very far from being fulfilled. The exact opposite happened. Since then, I expect most of us who made the trip have been asked the question, was not that voyage to the south an excessively wearisome and tedious business? Didn't you get sick of all those dogs? How on earth did you manage to keep them alive? It goes without saying that a 5 months' voyage in such waters as we were navigating must necessarily present a good deal of monotony. How much will depend on what resources one has for providing occupation. In this respect, we had in these very dogs just what was wanted. No doubt it was work that very often called for the exercise of patience. Nevertheless, like any other work, it furnished diversion and amusement. And so much the more, since we here had to deal with living creatures that had sense enough fully to appreciate and reciprocate in their own way any advance that was made to them. From the very first, I tried in every way to insist upon the paramount importance to our whole enterprise of getting our draft animals successfully conveyed to our destination. If we had any watchword at this time, it was, "Dogs first, and dogs all the time." The result speaks best for the way in which this watchword was followed. The following was the arrangement we made. The dogs, who at first were always tied up on the same spot, were divided into parties of 10. To each party one or two keepers were assigned, with full responsibility for their animals and their treatment. For my own share, I took the 14 that lived on the bridge. Feeding the animals was a maneuver that required the presence of all hands on deck. It therefore took place when the watch was changed. The Arctic dog's greatest enjoyment in life is putting away his food. It may safely be asserted that the way to his heart lies through his dish of meat. We acted on this principle, and the result did not disappoint us. After the lapse of a few days, the different squads were the best of friends with their respective keepers. As may be supposed, it was not altogether to the taste of the dogs to stand chained up all the time. Their temperament is far too lively for that. We would gladly have allowed them the pleasure of running about and thus getting healthy exercise, but for the present we dared not run the risk of letting the whole pack loose. A little more education was required first. It was easy enough to win their affection. To provide them with a good education was, of course, a more difficult matter. It was quite touching to see their joy and gratitude when one gave up a little time to their entertainment. One's first meeting with them, in the morning, was specially cordial. Their feelings were then apt to find vent in a chorus of joyful howls. This was called forth by the very sight of their masters, but they asked more than that. They were not satisfied until we had gone round, patting and talking to every one. If by chance one was so careless as to miss a dog, he at once showed the most unmistakable signs of disappointment. There can hardly be an animal that is capable of expressing its feelings to the same extent as the dog. Joy, sorrow, gratitude, scruples of conscience, all are reflected as plainly as could be desired in his behavior, and above all in his eyes. We human beings are apt to cherish the conviction that we have a monopoly of what is called a living soul. The eyes, it is said, are the mirror of this soul. That is all right enough, but now take a look at a dog's eyes. Study them attentively. How often do we see something human in their expression? The same variations that we meet with in human eyes. This, at all events, is something that strikingly resembles soul. We will leave the question open for those who are interested in its solution, and will here only mention another point which seems to show that a dog is something more than a mere machine of flesh and blood, his pronounced individuality. There were about 100 dogs on board the Fram. Gradually, as we got to know each one of them by daily intercourse, they each revealed some characteristic trait, some peculiarity. Hardly two of them were alike, either in disposition or in appearance. To an observant eye, there was here ample opportunity for the most amusing exercise. If now and then one grew a little tired of one's fellow men, which I must admit seldom happened, there was, as a rule, diversion to be found in the society of the animals. I say, as a rule, there were, of course, exceptions. It was not an unmixed pleasure having the whole deck full of dogs for all those months. Our patience was severely tested many a time. But in spite of all the trouble and inconvenience to which the transport of the dogs necessarily gave rise, I am certainly right in saying that these months of sea voyage would have seemed far more monotonous and tedious if we had been without our passengers. During the first 4 or 5 days, we had now been making our way towards the Straits of Dover, and the hope began to dawn within us that this time, at last, we should slip through without any great difficulty. There had been 5 days of absolute calm. Why should it not last out the week? But it did not. As we passed the lightship at the western end of the Goodwins, the fine weather left us, and in its place came the southwest wind with rain, fog, and foul weather in its train. In the course of half an hour it became so thick that it was impossible to see more than 2 or 3 ship's lengths ahead, but if we could see nothing, we heard all the more. The ceaseless shrieks of many steam whistles and sirens told us only too plainly what a crowd of vessels we were in. It was not exactly a pleasant situation. Our excellent ship had many good points, but they did not prevent her from being extraordinarily slow and awkward in turning. This is an element of great danger in these waters. It must be remembered that a possible accident, whether our own fault or not, would to us be absolutely fatal. We had so little time to spare that the resulting delay might ruin the whole enterprise. An ordinary trading vessel can take the risk. By careful maneuvering, a skipper can almost always keep out of the way. Collisions are, as a rule, the result of rashness or carelessness on one side or another. The rash one has to pay. The careful one may perhaps make money out of it. Carefulness on our part was a matter of course. It would have been a poor consolation to us if another ship had had to pay for her carelessness. We could not take that risk. Therefore, little as we liked doing so, we put into the Downs and anchored there. Right opposite to us, we had the town of Deal, then in the height of its season. The only amusement we had was to observe all these apparently unconcerned people who passed their time in bathing or walking about the white, inviting sands. They had no need to worry themselves much about what quarter the wind blew from. Our only wish was that it would veer or in any case drop. Our communication with the land was limited to sending ashore telegrams and letters for home. By the next morning our patience was already quite exhausted, but not so with the southwester. It kept going as steadily as ever. But it was clear weather, and therefore we decided at once to make an attempt to get to the west. There was nothing to be done but to have recourse to the ancient method of beating. We cleared one point, and then another, but more than that we could not manage for the time being. We took one bearing after another. No, there was no visible progress. Off Dungeness we had to anchor again, and once more console ourselves with the much-vaunted balm of patience. This time we escaped with passing the night there. The wind now thought fit to veer sufficiently to let us get out at daybreak, but it was still a contrary wind, and we had to beat almost all the way down the English Channel. A whole week was spent in doing these 300 miles. That was rather hard, considering the distance we had to go. I fancy most of us gave a good sigh of relief when at last we were clear of the Scilly Isles. The everlasting southwest wind was still blowing, but that did not matter so much now. The main thing was that we found ourselves in open sea, with the whole Atlantic before us. Perhaps one must have sailed in the Fram to be fully able to understand what a blessing it was to feel ourselves altogether clear of the surrounding land and the many sailing ships in the channel, to say nothing of constantly working the ship with a deck swarming with dogs. On our first voyage through the channel in June, we had caught 2 or 3 carrier pigeons, which had come to rest in the rigging utterly tired out. On the approach of darkness, we were able to get hold of them without difficulty. Their numbers and marks were noted, and after they had been taken care of for a couple of days and had recovered their strength, we let them go. They circled once or twice round the mastheads, and then made for the English coast. I think this episode led to our taking a few carrier pigeons with us when we left Christiansland. Lieutenant Nilsen, as a former owner of pigeons, was to take charge of them. Then a nice house was made for them, and the pigeons lived happily in their new abode on the top of the whaleboat amidships. Now, in some way or other, the second-in-command found out that the circulation of air in the pigeon-house was faulty. To remedy this defect, he one day set the door a little ajar. Air certainly got into the house, but the pigeons came out. A joker, on discovering that the birds had flown, wrote up "To Let" in big letters on the wall of the pigeon-house. The second-in-command was not in a very gentle frame of mind that day. As far as I know, the escape took place in the channel. The pigeons found their way home to Norway. The Bay of Biscay has bad name among seamen, and it fully deserves it. That tempestuous corner of the sea conceals forever in its depths so many a stout ship and her crew. We, for our part, however, had good hopes of escaping unharmed, considering the time of year, and our hopes were fulfilled. We had better luck than we dared to anticipate. Our stubborn opponent, the southwest wind, got tired at last of trying to stop our progress. It was no use. We went slowly, it was true, but still we got along. Of the meteorological lessons of our youth, we especially recalled at that moment the frequent northerly winds off the coast of Portugal, and as a pleasant surprise we already had them far up in the bay. This was an agreeable change after all our close-hauled tacking in the channel. The north wind held almost as bravely as the southwest had done before, and at what was to our ideas quite a respectable rate, we went southward day after day towards the fine weather zone, where we could be sure of a fair wind, and where a sailor's life is, as a rule, a pleasant one. For that matter, as far as seamanship was concerned, our work had gone on smoothly enough even during these first difficult weeks. There were always willing and practiced hands enough for what was wanted, even though the work to be done was frequently of a not very pleasant kind. Take washing decks, for instance. Every seaman will have something to say about what it is like on board ships that carry live animals, especially when these are carried on deck, in the way of all work that has to be done. I have always held the opinion that a polar ship ought not, any more than any other vessel, to be a wholesale establishment for dirt and filth, however many dogs there may be on board. On the contrary, I should say that on voyages of this kind, it is more than ever vitally necessary to keep one's surroundings as clean and sweet as possible. The important thing is to get rid of anything that may have a demoralizing and depressing effect. The influence of uncleanliness, in this way, is so well known that it is needless to preach about it here. My views were shared by everyone on board the Fram, and everything was done to act in accordance with them, in spite of what may be considered great difficulties. Twice a day the whole deck was thoroughly washed down, besides all the extra turns at odd times with bucket and scrubber. At least once a week the whole of the loose deck was taken up, and each separate part of it thoroughly washed until it was clean as when it was laid down at Christiansland. This was a labor that required great patience and perseverance on the part of those who had to perform it, but I never saw any shortcomings. "Let's just see and get it clean," they said. At night, when it was not always easy to see what one was doing, it might often happen that one heard some more or less heated exclamations from those who had to handle coils of rope in working the ship. I need not hint more explicitly at the cause of them, if it is remembered that there were dogs lying about everywhere, who had eaten and drunk well in the course of the day. But after a time the oaths gave way to jokes. There's nothing in the world that custom does not help us to get over. It is the universal practice on board ship to divide the day and night into watches of 4 hours. The two watches into which the crew is divided relieve each other every 4 hours, but on vessels that sail to the Arctic Ocean it is customary to have watches of 6 hours. We adopted the latter plan, which, on its being put to the vote, proved to have a compact majority in its favor. By this arrangement of watches we only had to turn out twice in the course of 24 hours, and the watch below had had a proper sleep whenever it turned out. If one has to eat, smoke, and perhaps chat a little during 4 hours' watch below, it does not leave much time for sleeping, and if there should be a call for all hands on deck it means no sleep at all. To cope with the work of the engine room, we had from the beginning the two engineers, Sundbeck and Nodvet. They took watch and watch, 4 hours each, when the motor was in use for a long time continuously. This was a rather severe duty, and on the whole it was just as well to have a man in reserve. I therefore decided to have a third man trained as reserve engineer. Christensen applied for this post, and it may be said in his praise that he accomplished the change remarkably well. Thorough deckhand as he was, there might have been reason to fear that he would repent of the transfer, but no, he quickly became life and soul an engineer. This did not prevent our seeing him on deck many a time during the passage through the west wind belt, when there was need of a good man during a gale. The motor, which during the Atlantic cruise had been a constant source of uneasiness and anxiety, regained our entire confidence under Sundbeck's capable command. It hummed so that it was a pleasure to hear it. To judge from the sound of the engine room, one would have thought the Fram was moving through the water with the speed of a torpedo boat. If this was not the case, the engine was not to blame. Possibly the screw had a share of it. The latter ought probably to have been somewhat larger, though experts are not agreed about this. In any case, there was something radically wrong with our propeller. Whenever there was a little seaway, it was apt to work loose in the brasses. This disadvantage is of very common occurrence in vessels which have to be fitted with lifting propellers on account of the ice, and we did not escape it. The only remedy was to lift the whole propeller frame and renew the brasses. an extremely difficult work when it had to be done in the open sea and on as lively a ship as the Fram. Day by day we had the satisfaction of seeing how the dogs found themselves more and more at home on board. Perhaps even among ourselves there were one or two who had felt some doubt at first of what the solution of the dog question would be, but in any case all such doubts were soon swept away. Even at an early stage of the voyage we had every reason to hope that we should land our animals safe and sound. What we had to see in the first place was to let them have as much and as good food as circumstances permitted. As already mentioned, we had provided ourselves with dried fish for their consumption. Eskimo dogs do not suffer very greatly from daintiness, but an exclusive diet of dried fish would seem rather monotonous in the long run, even to their appetites. And a certain addition of fatty substances was necessary, otherwise we should have some trouble with them. We had on board several great barrels of tallow or fat, but our store was not so large that we did not have to economize. In order to make the supply of fat last, and at the same time to induce our boarders to take as much dried fish as possible, we invented a mixture which was called by a sailor's term, denja. This must not be confused with thrashing, which was also served out liberally from time to time, but the denja was more in demand. It consisted of a mixture of chopped up fish, tallow, and maize meal, all boiled together into a sort of porridge. This dish was served 3 times a week, and the dogs were simply mad for it. They very soon learned to keep count of the days when this mess was to be expected, and as soon as they heard the rattling of the tin dishes in which separate portions were carried round, they set up such a noise that it was impossible to hear oneself speak. Both the preparation and the serving out of this extra ration were at times rather troublesome, but it was well worth it. It is quite certain that our complement of dogs would have made a poor show on arrival at the Bay of Whales if we had shrunk from the trouble. The dried fish was not nearly so popular as the denja, but to make up for that there was plenty of it. Not that the dogs themselves ever thought they could have enough. Indeed, they were always stealing from their neighbors, perhaps more for the sake of the sport than for anything else. In any case, as sport was extremely popular, and it took many a good hiding to get the rascals to understand that it could not be allowed. I'm afraid, though, that they kept up their thieving even after they knew very well that it was wrong. The habit was too old to be corrected. Another habit, and a very bad one, that these Eskimo dogs have fallen into in the course of ages, and of which we tried to break them, at all events during the sea voyage, is their tendency to hold howling concerts. What the real meaning of these performances may be, whether they are a pastime or an expression of gratification or the reverse, we could never decide to our satisfaction. They began suddenly and without warning. The whole pack might be lying perfectly still and quiet when a single individual, who for that occasion had taken upon himself the part of leader of the chorus, would set up a long, blood-curdling yowl. If they were left to themselves, it was not long before the whole pack joined in, and this infernal din was kept going at full steam for 2 or 3 minutes. The only amusing thing about the entertainment was its conclusion. They all stopped short at the same instant, just as a well-trained chorus obeys the baton of its conductor. Those of us, however, who happened to be in our bunks, found nothing at all amusing in these concerts, either in the finale or anything else, for they were calculated to tear the soundest sleeper from his slumbers. But if only one took care to stop the leader in his efforts, the whole affair was nipped in the bud, and we usually succeeded in doing this. If there were some who at first were anxious about their night's rest, these fears were soon dispersed. On leaving Norway, we had 97 dogs in all, and of these no less than 10 were bitches. This fact justified us in expecting an increase of the canine population on our voyage to the south, and our expectations were very soon fulfilled. The first happy event occurred when we had been no more than 3 weeks at sea. An incident of this kind may seem, in itself, of no great importance. To us, living under conditions in which one day was almost exactly like another, it was more than enough to be an object of the greatest interest. Therefore, when the report went round that Camilla had got 4 shapely youngsters, there was general rejoicing. 2 of the pups, who happened to be of the male sex, were allowed to live. The females were sent out of this world long before their eyes were opened to its joys and sorrows. It might be thought that seeing we had nearly 100 grown-up dogs on board, there would be little opportunity for looking after puppies. That this was done, nevertheless, with all the care that could be wished, is due in the first instance to the touching affection of the second in command for the little ones. From the very first moment he was their avowed protector. Gradually, as the numbers increased, there was a difficulty in finding room on the already well-occupied deck. "I'll take them in my bunk," said the second in command. It did not come to that, but if it had been necessary he would certainly have done so. The example was catching. Later on, when the little chaps were weaned and had begun to take other nourishment, one might see regularly and after every meal one after another of the crew coming on deck with some carefully scrapped up bits of food on his plate. The little hungry mouths were to have what was left over. Something more than patience and punctual performance of duty is displayed in such things as those of which I have been speaking. It is love of and a living interest in one's work. From what I saw and heard every day, I was certain that these necessary incentives were present, although, as far as most of the men were concerned, our object was still the protracted one of drifting for years in the Arctic ice. The extension of the plan, the far more imminent battle with the ice floes of the south, was still undreamt of by the majority of the ship's company. I considered it necessary to keep it to myself for a little while yet, until our departure from the port we were now making for, Funchal, Madeira. It may possibly appear to many people that I was running a pretty big risk in thus putting off till the last moment the duty of informing my comrades of the very considerable detour we were to make. Suppose some, or perhaps all of them, had objected. It must be admitted that it was a big risk, but there were so many risks that had to be taken at that time. However, as I got to know each man during these first few weeks of our long voyage, I soon arrived at the conviction that there was nobody on board the Fram who would try to put difficulties in the way. On the contrary, I had more and more reason to hope that they would all receive the news with joy when they heard it, for then their whole prospect would be so different. Everything had gone with surprising ease up to this time. In future, it would go even better. It was not without a certain longing that I looked forward to our arrival at Madeira. It would be grand to be able to speak out. No doubt the others who knew of the plan were equally eager. Secrets are neither amusing nor easy to carry about, least of all on board a ship where one has to live at such close quarters as we had. We were chatting together every day, of course, and the uninitiated could not be deterred from leading the conversation round to the ugly difficulties that would embitter our lives and hinder our progress when rounding the Horn. It was likely enough that we should manage to bring the dogs safely through the tropics once, but whether we should succeed in doing so twice was more doubtful, and so on to infinity. It is easier to imagine than to describe how awkward all this was, and how cunningly one had to choose one's words to avoid saying too much. Among inexperienced men there would have been no great difficulty, but it must be remembered that on the Fram pretty nearly every second man had spent years of his life in polar voyages. A single slight hint to them would have been enough to expose the whole plan. That neither those on board nor anyone else discovered it prematurely can only be explained by its being so obvious. Our ship was a good deal too dependent on wind and weather to enable us to make any accurate estimate of the time our voyage would occupy, especially as regards those latitudes in which the winds are variable. The estimate for the whole voyage was based on an average speed of 4 knots, and at this very modest rate, as it may seem, we ought to arrive at the ice barrier about the middle of January, 1911. As will be seen later, this was realized with remarkable exactness. For reaching Madeira, we had allowed a month as a reasonable time. We did a good deal better than this, as we were able to leave Funchal a month to the day after our departure from Christiansland. We were always ready to forgive the estimate when it was at fault in this way. The delay to which we had been subjected in the English Channel was fortunately made up along the coast of Spain and to the south of it. The north wind held until we were in the northeast trade, and then we were all right. On September 5, our observations at noon told us that we might expect to see the lights that evening, and at 10 p.m., the light of San Lorenzo on the little island of Fora near Madeira was reported from the rigging. End of Section 8. End of Chapter 3, On the Way to the South.
Section 09 of the South Pole. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Dick Durrett. The South Pole by Roald Amundsen. Translation by A. G. Carter. Section 09, Volume 1, Chapter 4. From Madeira to the Barrier, Part 1. On the following morning we anchored in Funchal Roads. My brother was to arrive at Funchal by arrangement early enough to be sure of proceeding us there. It was, however, a good while before we saw anything of him, and we were already flattering ourselves that we had arrived first when he was suddenly observed in a boat coming under our stern. We were able to tell him that all was well on board, and he brought us a big packet of letters and newspapers that gave us news of home. A little officious gentleman, who said he was a doctor, and as such had come in an official capacity to inquire as to the state of our health, was in an amazing hurry to leave the ship again, when at the top of the gangway he found himself confronted with a score of dogs' jaws, which at the moment were opened wide on account of the heat. The learned man's interest in our health had suddenly vanished. His thoughts flew to the safety of his own life and limbs. As Funchal was the last place where we could communicate with the outside world, arrangements were made for completing our supplies in every possible way, and in particular we had to take on board all the fresh water we could. The consumption of this commodity would be very large, and the possibility of running short had to be avoided at any price. For the time being, we could no more than fill all our tanks and every imaginable receptacle with the precious fluid, and this was done. We took about 1,000 gallons in the long boat that was carried just above the main hatch. This was rather a risky experiment, which might have had awkward consequences in the event of the vessel rolling, but we consoled ourselves with the hope of fine weather and a smooth sea during the next few weeks. During the stay at Funchal, the dogs had 2 good meals of fresh meat as a very welcome variety in their diet. A fair-sized carcass of a horse disappeared with impressive rapidity at each of these banquets. For our own use, we naturally took a plentiful supply of vegetables and fruits, which were here to be had in abundance. It was the last opportunity we should have of regaling ourselves with such luxuries. Our stay at Funchal was somewhat longer than was intended at first, as the engineers found it necessary to take up the propeller and examine the brasses. This work would occupy 2 days, and while the 3 mechanics were toiling in the heat, the rest of the ship's company took the opportunity of becoming acquainted with the town and its surroundings. The crew had a day's leave, half at a time. An excursion was arranged to one of the numerous hotels that are situated on the heights of the town. The ascent is easily made by means of a funicular railway, and in the course of the half hour it takes to reach the top, one is able to get an idea of the luxuriant fertility of the island. At the hotels, one finds a good cuisine, and, of course, still better wine. It is scarcely necessary to add that we did full justice to both. For the descent, a more primitive means of transport was employed. We came down on sledges. It may be startling to hear of sledging in Madeira, but I must explain that the sledges had wooden runners, and that the road was paved with a black stone that was very smooth. We went at a creditable pace down the steep inclines, each sledge being drawn or pushed by 3 or 4 swarthy natives who seemed to be possessed of first-rate legs and lungs. It may be mentioned as a curiosity that the newspapers of Funchal did not hesitate to connect our expedition with the South Pole. The native journalists had no idea of the value of the startling piece of news they were circulating. It was a canard invented on the supposition that when a polar ship steers to the south, she must, of course, be making for the South Pole. In this case, the canard happened to be true. Fortunately for us, it did not fly beyond the shores of Madeira. By the afternoon of September 9, we could begin to make our preparations for departure. The engineers had replaced the propeller and tested it. All supplies were on board, and the chronometers had been checked. All that remained was to get rid of the importunate bumboat men who swarmed around the vessel in their little craft, each looking like a small floating shop. These obtrusive fellows were quickly sent off down the gangway. Besides ourselves, only my brother was left on board. Now that we were thus completely isolated from the outer world, the long-expected moment had arrived when I could proceed to inform all my comrades of my decision, now a year old, to make for the south. I believe all who were on board will long remember that sultry afternoon in Funchal Roads. All hands were called on deck. What they thought of, I do not know, but it was hardly Antarctica and the South Pole. Lieutenant Nilsen carried a big rolled-up chart. I could see that this chart was the object of many interrogative glances. Not many words were needed before everyone could see where the wind lay and what course we should steer henceforward. The second in command unrolled his big chart of the southern hemisphere, and I briefly explained the extended plan, as well as my reasons for keeping it secret until this time. Now and again I had to glance at their faces. At first, as might be expected, they showed the most unmistakable signs of surprise, but this expression swiftly changed, and before I had finished, they were all bright with smiles. I was now sure of the answer I should get when I finally asked each man whether he was willing to go on, and as the names were called, every single man had his yes ready. Although, as I have said, I had expected it to turn out as it did, it is difficult to express the joy I felt at seeing how promptly my comrades placed themselves at my service on this momentous occasion. It appeared, however, that I was not the only one who was pleased. There was so much life and good spirits on board that evening that one would have thought the work was successfully accomplished instead of being hardly begun. For the present, however, there was not much time to spare for discussing the news. We had first to see about getting away. Afterwards, there would be many months before us. 2 hours' grace was allowed, in which every man could write to his people at home about what had just passed. The letters were probably not long ones, at all events, and they were soon finished. The mail was handed over to my brother to take to Christiania, from whence the letters were sent to their respective destinations, but this did not take place until after the alteration of our plans had been published in the press. It had been easy enough to tell my comrades the news, and they could not have given it a better reception. It was another question what people at home would say when the intelligence reached their ears. We afterwards heard that both favorable and unfavorable opinions were expressed. For the moment, we could not trouble ourselves very greatly with that side of the matter. My brother had undertaken to announce the way we had taken, and I cannot say that I envied him the task. After we had all given him a final hearty shake of the hand, he left us, and thereby our communications with the busy world was broken off. We were left to our own resources. No one can say that the situation oppressed us greatly. Our long voyage was entered upon as though it were a dance. There was not a trace of the more or less melancholy feeling that usually accompanies any parting. The men joked and laughed, while witticisms, both good and bad, were bandied about on the subject of our original situation. The anchor came up more quickly than usual, and after the motor had helped us to escape from the oppressive heat of the harbour, we had the satisfaction of seeing every sail filled with a fresh and cooling northeast trade. The dogs, who must have found the stay at Funchal rather too warm for their taste, expressed their delight at the welcome breeze by getting up a concert. We felt we could not grudge them the pleasure this time. It was pure enjoyment to come on deck the morning after leaving Madeira. There was an added note of friendliness in every man's good morning, and a smile twinkled in the corner of every eye. The entirely new turn things had taken, and the sudden change to fresh fields for thought and imagination, acted as a beneficent stimulus to those who, the day before, had contemplated a trip round the Horn. I think what chiefly amused them was their failure to smell a rat before. How could I have been such an ass as not to think of it long ago, said Beck, as he sent a nearly new quid into the sea. Of course, it was as plain as a pikestaff. Here we are with all these dogs, this fine observation house, with its big kitchen range and shiny cloth on the table, and everything else. Any fool might have seen what it meant. I consoled him with the remark that it is always easy to be wise after the event, and that I thought it very lucky no one had discovered our destination prematurely. Those of us who had been obliged hitherto to keep to themselves what they knew, and to resort to all kinds of stratagems to avoid making any disclosure, were certainly no less pleased at being rid of the secret. Now they could talk freely to their heart's content. If we had previously had to resort to mystification, there was now nothing to prevent our laying our cards on the table. So many a conversation had come to a standstill because those who had a number of questions to ask did not dare to put them, and those who could have told held their tongues. Hereafter, it would be a very long time before we were at a loss for subjects of conversation. A theme had suddenly presented itself, so varied and comprehensive that it was difficult at first to know where to begin. There were many men on board the Fram with a wealth of experience gained during years spent within the Arctic Circle, but to almost all of us the great Antarctic continent was a terra incognita. I myself was the only man on board who had seen Antarctica. Perhaps one or two of my companions had in former days passed in the vicinity of an Antarctic iceberg on a voyage round Cape Horn, but that was all. What had previously been accomplished in the way of exploration in the south, and the narratives of the men who had endeavored to extend our knowledge of that inhospitable continent, were also things that very few of the ship's company had had time or opportunity to study, nor had they perhaps had any reason to do so. Now there was every possible reason. I considered it an imperative necessity that every man should acquaint himself as far as possible with the work of previous expeditions. This was the only way of becoming in some measure familiar with the conditions in which we should have to work. For this reason, the Fram carried a whole library of Antarctic literature, containing everything that has been written by the long succession of explorers in these regions, from James Cook and James Clark Ross to Captain Scott and Sir Ernest Shackleton. And indeed, good use was made of this library. The works of the two last-named explorers were in chief request. They were read from cover to cover by all who could do so, and, well written and excellently illustrated as these narratives are, they were highly instructive. But if ample time was thus devoted to the theoretical study of our problem, the practical preparations were not neglected. As soon as we were in the trade winds, where the virtually constant direction and force of the wind permitted a reduction of the watch on deck, the various specialists went to work to put our extensive wintering outfit in the best possible order. It is true that every precaution had been taken beforehand to have every part of the equipment as good and as well adapted to its purpose as possible, but the whole of it, nevertheless, required a thorough overhauling. With so complicated an outfit as ours was, one is never really at the end of one's work. It will always be found that some improvement or other can be made. It will appear later that we had our hands more than full of the preparations for the sledge journey, not only during the long sea voyage, but also during the still longer Antarctic winter. Our sailmaker, Ronnie, was transformed into a, well, let us call it tailor. Ronnie's pride was a sewing machine which he had obtained from the yard at Horten after considerable use of his persuasive tongue. His greatest sorrow on the voyage was that, on arriving at the barrier, he would be obliged to hand over his treasure to the shore party. He could not understand what we wanted with a sewing machine at Framheim. The first thing he did when the Fram reached Buenos Aires was to explain to the local representative of the Singer Sewing Machine Company how absolutely necessary it was to have his loss made good. His gift of persuasion helped him again, and he got a new machine. For that matter, it was not surprising that Ronnie was fond of his machine. He could use it for all sorts of things. Sailmakers, shoemakers, saddlers, and tailors' work was all turned out with equal celerity. He established his workshop in the chart house, and there the machine hummed incessantly through the tropics, the west wind belt, and the ice floes too, for quick as our sailmaker was with his fingers, the orders poured in even more quickly. Ronnie was one of those men whose ambition it is to get as much work as possible done in the shortest possible time, and with increasing astonishment he saw that here he would never be finished. He might go at it as hard as he liked, there was always something more. To reckon up all that he delivered from his workshop during these months would take us too long. It is enough to say that all the work was remarkably well done and executed with admirable rapidity. Perhaps one of the things he personally prided himself most on having made was the little three-man tent which was afterwards left at the South Pole. It was a little masterpiece of a tent, made of thin silk, which when folded together would easily have gone into a fair-sized pocket and weighed hardly a kilogramme. At this time we could not count with certainty on the possibility of all those who made the southern journey reaching latitude 90 degrees. On the contrary, we had to be prepared for the probability of some of the party being obliged to turn back. It was intended that we should use the tent in question, in case it might be decided to let two or three men make the final dash, and therefore it was made as small and light as possible. Fortunately, we had no need to use it, as every man reached the goal, and we then found that the best way of disposing of Ronnie's work of art was to let it stay there as a mark. Our sailmaker had no dogs of his own to look after. He had no time for that. On the other hand, he often assisted me in attending to my 14 friends up on the bridge, but he seemed to have some difficulty in getting on terms of familiarity with the dogs and all that belonged to them. It did not quite agree with his idea of life on board ship to have a deck swarming with dogs. He regarded this abnormal state of things with a sort of scornful compassion. "So you carry dogs too aboard this ship," he would say, every time he came on deck and found himself face to face with the brutes. The poor brutes, I am sure, made no attempt to attack Ronnie's person more than anyone else's, but he seemed for a long time to have great doubts about it. I don't think he felt perfectly safe until the dogs had been muzzled. As part of our equipment to which we gave special care was, of course, the ski. In all probability, they would be our chief weapon in the coming fight. However much we might have to learn from Scott's and Shackleton's narratives, it was difficult for us to understand their statements that the use of ski on the barrier was not a success. From the descriptions that were given of the nature of the surface and the general conditions, we were forced to the opposite conclusion that ski were the only means to employ. Nothing was spared to provide a good skiing outfit, and we had an experienced man in charge of it, Olav Gjelland. It is sufficient to mention his name. When on leaving Norway, it was a question of finding a good place for our 20 pairs of ski. We found we should have to share our own quarters with them. They were all disposed under the ceiling of the fore cabin. At any rate, we had no better place to put them. Jarlin, who during the last month or two had tried his hand at the unaccustomed work of a seaman, went back to his old trade of ski maker and carpenter when we came into the trade winds. Both ski and bindings were delivered ready for use by Hagen and Company of Christiania. It remained to adapt them and fit the backstraps to each man's boots so that all might be ready for use on arrival at the barrier. A full skiing outfit had been provided for every man, so that those who were to be left on board might also have a run now and then during their stay at the ice edge. For each of our 10 sledges, Jarlin made during the voyage a pair of loose runners, which it was intended to use in the same way as the Eskimo used theirs. These primitive people have, or at any event had, no material that was suited for shoeing sledge runners. They got over the difficulty by covering the runners with a coating of ice. No doubt it requires a great deal of practice and patience to put on this kind of shoeing properly, but when it is once on, there can be no question that this device throws all others into the shade. As I say, we had intended to try this on the barrier. We found, however, that the pulling power of our teams was so good as to allow us to retain our steel shod runners with an easy conscience. For the first 14 days after leaving Madeira, the northeast trade was fresh enough to enable us to keep up our average rate, or a little more, with the help of the sails alone. The engine was therefore allowed a rest, and the engineers had an opportunity of cleaning and polishing it. This they did early and late, till it seemed as if they could never get it bright enough. Nordveldt now had a chance of devoting himself to the occupation which is his delight in this world, that of the blacksmith, and indeed there was opportunity enough for his use of the hammer and anvil. If Rönne had plenty of sewing, Nordveldt had no less forging, sledge fittings, knives, pickaxes, bars and bolts, patent hooks by the hundred for dogs, chains, and so on to infinity. The clang and sparks of the anvil were going all day long, till we were well into the Indian Ocean, and in the westerly belt of the blacksmith's lot was not an enviable one. It is not always easy to hit the nail on the head when one's feet rest on so unstable a foundation as the Fram's deck, nor is it altogether pleasant when the forge is filled with water several times a day. While we were fitting out for the voyage, the cry was constantly raised in certain quarters at home that the old Fram's hull was in a shocking state. It was said to be in bad repair, to leak like a sieve, in fact, to be altogether rotten. It throws a curious light on these reports when we look at the voyages that the Fram has accomplished in the last 2 years. For 20 months out of the 24, she has kept going in open sea, and that too in waters which make very serious demands on a vessel's strength. She is just as good as when she sailed, and could easily do it all over again without any repairs. We who were on board all knew perfectly well before we sailed how groundless and foolish these cries about her rottenness were. We knew, too, that there is scarcely a wooden ship afloat on which it is not necessary to use the pumps now and then. When the engine was stopped, we found it was sufficient to take a 10 minutes turn at the hand pump every morning. That was all the leaking amounted to. Oh no, there was nothing wrong with the Fram's hull. On the other hand, there might be a word or two to say about the rigging. If this was not all it should have been, the fault lay entirely with the plaguey considerations of our budget. On the foremast we had 2 square sails. There ought to have been 4. On the jib boom there were 2 staysails. There was room enough for 3, but the money would not run to it. In the trades we tried to make up for the deficiency by rigging a studding sail alongside the foresail and a skysail above the topsail. I will not assert that these improved sails contributed to improve the vessel's appearance, but they got her along, and that is a great deal more important. We made very fair progress southward during these September days, and before the month was half over we had come a good way into the tropical belt. No particularly tropical heat was felt, at any rate by us men, and as a rule the heat is not severely felt on board ship in open sea so long as the vessel is moving. On a sailing ship lying becalmed with the sun in the zenith, it might be warmer than one would wish, but in case of calms we had the engines to help us, and know that there was always a little breeze, that is, on deck. Down below it was worse, sometimes hoggishly mild, as Beck used to put it. Our otherwise comfortable cabins had one fault. There were no portholes in the ship's side, and therefore we could not get a draught. but most of us managed without shifting our quarters. Of the two saloons, the fore saloon was decidedly preferable in warm weather. In a cold climate, probably the reverse would be the case. We were able to secure a thorough draught of air forward through the alleyway leading to the forecastle. It was difficult to get a good circulation aft, where they also had the warm proximity of the engines. The engineers, of course, had the hottest place, but the ever-invented Sundbeck devised a means of improving the ventilation of the engine room, so that even there they were not so badly off under the circumstances. One often hears it asked, which is to be preferred, severe heat or severe cold? It is not easy to give a definite answer. Neither of the two is pleasant, and it must remain a matter of taste which is least so. On board ship, no doubt most people will vote for heat, as even if the days are rather distressing, one has the glorious nights to make up for them. A bitterly cold day is poorly compensated for by an even colder night. One decided advantage of warm climate for men who have to be frequently in and out of their clothes and their bunks is the simplicity of costume which it allows. When you wear hardly anything, it takes a very short time to dress. If we had been able to take the opinion of our dogs on their existence in the tropics, they would probably have answered as one dog, "Thanks, let us get back to rather cooler surroundings." Their coats were not exactly calculated for a temperature of 90 degrees in the shade, and the worst of it was that they could not change them. It is, by the way, a misunderstanding to suppose that these animals absolutely must have hard frost to be comfortable. On the contrary, they prefer to be nice and warm. Here in the tropics, of course, they had rather too much of a good thing, but they did not suffer from the heat. By stretching awnings over the whole ship, we contrived that they should all be constantly in the shade, and so long as they were not directly exposed to the sun's rays, there was no fear of anything going wrong. How well they came through it appears best from the fact that not one of them was on the sick list on account of the heat. During the whole voyage, only two deaths occurred from sickness. One was the case of a bitch that died after giving birth to 8 pups, which might just as easily have caused her death under other conditions. What was the cause of death in the other case, we were unable to find out. At any rate, it was not an infectious disease. One of our greatest fears was the possibility of an epidemic among the dogs, but thanks to the care with which they had been picked, there was never a sign of anything of the sort. In the neighborhood of the equator, between the northeast and the southeast trades, lies what is called the Belt of Calms. The position and extent of this belt vary somewhat with the season. If you are extremely lucky, it may happen that one trade wind will practically take you over into the other, but as a rule, this region will cause quite a serious delay to sailing ships. Either there are frequent calms or shifting and unsteady winds. We arrived there at an unfavorable time of the year and lost the northeast trade as early as 10 degrees north of the line. If we had had the calm we looked for, we could have got across with the help of the engine in a reasonably short time, but we saw very little sign of calm. As a rule, there was an obstinate south wind blowing, and would not have taken very much of it to make the last few degrees of north latitude stiffer than we cared for. The delay was annoying enough, but we had another disappointment of a more serious kind, for, curiously enough, we never had a proper shower of rain. Generally, in these latitudes, one encounters extremely heavy downpours, which make it possible to collect water by the barrelful in a very short space of time, We had hoped in this way to increase our store of fresh water, which was not so large, but that extreme economy had to be practiced if we were to avoid running short. However, and this hope failed us, practically speaking. We managed to catch a little water, but it was altogether insufficient, and the husbanding of our supply had to be enforced in future with authority. The dogs required the daily ration, and they got it, measured out to a hair's breadth. Our own consumption was limited to what was strictly necessary. Soups were banished from the bill of fare. They used too much of the precious fluid. Washing in fresh water was forbidden. It must not be supposed that we had no opportunity of washing. We had a plentiful supply of soap, which lathered just as well in salt water as in fresh, and was thus capable of keeping ourselves and our clothes as clean as before. If for a time we had felt a certain anxiety about our water supply, these fears were banished comparatively quickly, as the reserve we had taken in the longboat on deck lasted an incredibly long time, almost twice as long as we had dared to hope, and this saved the situation, or very nearly so. If the worst came to the worst, we should be obliged to call it one of the numerous groups of islands that would lie in our route later on. For over 6 weeks, the dogs had now been chained up in the places assigned to them when they came on board. In the course of that time, most of them had become so tame and tractable that we thought we might soon let them loose. This would be a welcome change for them, and what was more important, it would give them an opportunity for exercise. To tell the truth, we all expected some amusement from it. There would certainly be a proper shindy when all this pack got loose, but before we gave them their liberty, we were obliged to disarm them. Otherwise, the inevitable free fight would be liable to result in one or more of them being left on the battlefield, and we could not afford that. Every one of them was provided with a strong muzzle. Then we let them loose and waited to see what would happen. At first, nothing at all happened. It looked as if they had abandoned once and for all the thought of ever moving from the spot they had occupied so long. At last, a solitary individual had the bright idea of attempting a walk along the deck. But he should not have done so. It was dangerous to move about there. The unaccustomed sight of a loose dog at once aroused his nearest neighbors. A dozen of them flung themselves upon the unfortunate animal who had been the first to leave his place, rejoicing in the thought of planting their teeth in his sinful body. But to their disappointment, the enjoyment was not so great as they expected. The confounded strap around their jaws made it impossible to get hold of the skin. The utmost they could do was to pull a few tufts of hair out of the object of their violent onslaught. This affair of outposts gave the signal for a general engagement all along the line. What an unholy row there was for the next couple of hours. The hair flew, but skins remained intact. The muzzles saved a good many lives that afternoon. These fights are the chief amusement of the Eskimo dogs. They follow the sport with genuine passion. There would be no great objection to it if they had not the peculiar habit of always combining to set upon a single dog, who is chosen as their victim for the occasion. They all make for this one, and if they are left to themselves, they will not stop until they have made an end of the poor beast. In this way, a valuable dog may be destroyed in a moment. We therefore naturally made every effort from the first to quench their love of fighting, and the dogs very soon began to understand that we were not particularly fond of their combats, but we had here to deal with a natural characteristic, which it is impossible to eradicate. In any case, one could never be sure that nature would not reassert itself over discipline. When the dogs had once been let loose, they remained free to run about wherever they liked for the remainder of the voyage. Only at mealtime were they tied up. It was quite extraordinary how they managed to hide themselves in every hole and corner. On some mornings there was hardly a dog to be seen when daylight came. Of course, they visited every place where they ought not to have gone. Several of them repeatedly took the opportunity of tumbling into the forehold when the hatches were open, but a fall of 25 feet did not seem to trouble them in the least. One even found his way into the engine room, difficult as it might seem to gain access to it, and curled himself up between the piston rods. Fortunately for the visitor, the engine was not started while he was there. When the first furious battles had been fought out, a calm soon settled upon the dog spirits. It was easy to notice a feeling of shame and disappointment in the champions when they found that all their efforts led to nothing. The sport had lost its principal charm as soon as they saw what a poor chance there was of tasting blood. From what has here been said, and perhaps from other accounts of the nature of Arctic dogs, it may appear as though the mutual relations of these animals consisted exclusively of fighting. This, however, is far from being the case. On the contrary, they very often force friendships which are sometimes so strong that one dog simply cannot live without the other. Before we let the dogs loose, we had remarked that there were a few who, for some reason or other, did not seem as happy as they should have been. They were more shy and restless than the others. No particular notice was taken of this, and no one tried to find out the cause of this. The day we left them loose, we discovered what had been the matter with the ones that had moped. They had some old friend who had chanced to be placed in some other part of the deck, and this separation had been the cause of their low spirits. It was really touching to see the joy they showed on meeting again. They became quite different animals. Of course, in these cases, a change of places was arranged between the different groups, so that those who had associated from their own inclination would in future be members of the same team. End of section 9. Recording by Dick Durrett, Manchester, New Hampshire, USA.
South Pole. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Naksha. The South Pole by Roald Amundsen. Translation by A.G. Carter. Section 10, Volume 1, Chapter 4, From Madeira to the Barrier, Part 2. We had expected to reach the equator by October 1st, but the unfavorable conditions of wind that we met with to the north of it caused us to be a little behind our reckoning, though not much. On the afternoon of October 4th, the Fram crossed the line. Thus an important stage of the voyage was concluded. The feeling that we had now reached the southern latitudes was enough to put us all in holiday humor, and we felt we must get a modest entertainment. According to ancient custom, crossing the line should be celebrated by a visit from Father Neptune himself, whose part is taken for the occasion by someone chosen from among the ship's company. If in the course of his inspection this august personage comes upon anyone who is unable to prove that he has already crossed the famous circle, he is handed over at once to the attendants to be shaved and baptized. This process, which is not always carried out with exaggerated gentleness, causes much amusement and forms a welcome variety in the monotonous life of a long sea voyage. And probably many on board the Fram looked forward with eagerness to Neptune's visit, but he did not come. There was simply no room for him on our already well-occupied deck. We contented ourselves with a special dinner, followed by coffee, liqueurs, and cigars. Coffee was served on the foredeck, whereby, moving a large number of dogs, we had contrived to get a few square yards of space. There was no lack of entertainment. A violin and mandolin orchestra, composed of Prestrud, Sunbeck, and Beck, contributed several pieces, and our excellent gramophone was heard for the first time, just as it started the waltz, from the Count of Luxembourg. There appeared in the companionway a real ballet girl, masked and in very short skirts. This unexpected apparition from a better world was greeted with warm applause, which was no less vigorous when the fair one had given proof of her skill in the art of dancing. Behind the mask could be detected Jurchen's face, but both costume and dance were in the highest degree feminine. Ron was not satisfied until he had the lady on his knees. Hooray for illusion! The gramophone now changed to a swinging American cakewalk, and at the same moment there opportunely appeared on the scene a nigger in a tailcoat, a silk hat, and a pair of wooden shoes. Black as he was, we saw at once that it was the second-in-command who had thus disguised himself. The mere sight of him was enough to set us all shrieking with laughter, but he made his great success when he began to dance. He was intensely amusing. It did us all a great deal of good to have a little amusement just then. This part of the voyage was a trial of patience more than anything else. Possibly we were rather hard to please, but the southeast trade, which we were expecting to meet every day, was, in our opinion, far too late in the coming. And when at length it arrived, it did not behave at all as becomes a wind that has the reputation of being the steadiest in the world. Besides being far too light, according to our requirements, it permitted itself such irregularities as swinging between the points of south and east. It was mostly in the neighbourhood of the former. For us, who had to lie all the time close-hauled to westward, this had the effect of increasing our western longitude a great deal faster than our latitude. We were rapidly approaching the northeastern point of South America, Cape San Roque. Fortunately, we escaped any closer contact with this headland, which shoots so far out into the Atlantic. The wind at last shifted aft, but it was so light that the motor had to be constantly in use. Slowly but surely, we now went southward, and the temperature again began to approach the limits that are fitting according to a northerner's ideas. The tiresome, rather low awning could be removed, and it was a relief to be rid of it, as one could then walk upright everywhere. On October 16th, according to observations at noon, we were in the vicinity of the island of South Trinidad, one of the lonely oases in the watery desert of South Atlantic. It was our intention to go under the island, and possibly to attempt a landing. But unfortunately, the motor had to be stopped for cleaning, and this prevented our approaching it by daylight. We caught a glimpse of the land at dusk, which was, at all events, enough to check our chronometers. South of the 20th degree of latitude, the southeast trade was nearly done with, and we were really not sorry to be rid of it. It remained light and scant to the last, and sailing on a wind is not a strong point with the Fram. In the part of the ocean where we now were, there was a hope of getting good wind, and it was wanted if we were to come out right. We had now covered 6,000 miles, but there were still 10,000 before us, and the days went by with astonishing rapidity. The end of October brought the change we wanted. With a fresh northerly breeze, we went gallantly southward, and before the end of the month, we were down in latitude 40 degrees. Here we had reached the waters where we were almost certain to have all the wind we wished, and from the right quarter. From now our course was eastward along what is known as the southern west wind belt. This belt extends between the 40th and 50th parallels all around Earth and is distinguished by the constant occurrence of westerly winds, which as a rule blow with great violence. We had put our trust in these west winds. If they failed us, we should be in a mess. But no sooner had we reached their domain than they were upon us with full force. It was no gentle treatment that we received, but the effect was excellent. We raced eastward. An intended call at Grove Island had to be abandoned. The sea was running too high for us to venture to approach the narrow little harbour. The month of October had put us all a good deal behind hand, but now we were making up the distance we had lost. We had reckoned on being south of Cape of Good Hope within 2 months after leaving Madeira, and this turned out correct. The day we passed the meridian of Cape, we had the first regular gale. The seas ran threateningly high, but now for the first time our splendid little ship showed what she was worth. A single one of these gigantic waves would have cleared our decks in an instant if it had not come on board, but the Fram did not permit any such impertinence. When they came up behind the vessel, and we might expect any moment to see them break over low after deck, she raised herself with such an elegant movement, and the wave had to be content with slipping underneath. An albatross could not have managed the situation better. It is said that the Fram was built for the ice, and that cannot, of course, be denied. But at the same time, it is certain that when Colin Archer created this famous masterpiece of an ice boat, she was just as much a masterpiece of a sea boat, a vessel it would be difficult to match for seaworthiness. To be able to avoid the seas as the Fram did, she had to roll, and this we had every opportunity of finding out. The whole long passage through the westerly belt was one continual rolling, but in course of time one got used to that discomfort. It was awkwardly enough, but less disagreeable than shipping water. Perhaps it was worse for those who had to work in the galley. It is no laughing matter to be cook when, for weeks together, you cannot put down so much as a coffee cup without its immediately turning a somersault. It requires both patience and strong will to carry it through. But the two, Lindstrom and Olsen, who looked after our food under these difficult conditions, had the gift of taking it all from the humorous point of view, and that was well. As regard the dogs, it mattered little to them whether a gale or storm was blowing, so long as the rain kept off. They hate rain. Wet in any form is the worst one can offer an Arctic dog. If the deck was wet, they would not lie down, but would remain standing motionless for hours, trying to take a nap in that uncomfortable position. Of course, they did not get much sleep in that way, but to make up for it, they could sleep all day and all night when the weather was fine. South of the Cape, we lost two dogs. They went overboard one dark night when the ship was rolling tremendously. We had a coal bunker on the port side after deck, reaching up to the height of bulwarks. Probably these fellows had been practicing boarding drill and lost their balance. We took precautions that the same thing should not happen again. Fortunately for our animals, the weather in the westerly belt was subject to very frequent changes. No doubt they had many a sleepless night, with rain, sleet and hail. But on the other hand, they never had to wait for very long for a cheerful glimpse of the sun. The wind is, for the most part, of cyclonic character, shifting suddenly from one quarter to another, and these shifts always involve a change of weather. When the barometer begins to fall, it is a sure warning of an approaching northwesterly wind, which is always accompanied by precipitation and increases in force until the fall of the barometer ceases. When this occurs, there follows either a short pause or else the wind suddenly shifts to the southwest and blows from that quarter with increasing violence while the barometer rises rapidly. This change of wind is almost always followed by a clearing of the weather. A circumstance which contributes to an element of risk to navigation in the latitudes where we found ourselves is the possibility of colliding with an iceberg in darkness or thick weather, for it sometimes happens that these sinister monsters, in the course of their wanderings, find a way well up into the 40s. The probability of a collision is, of course, in itself not very great, and it can be reduced to a minimum by taking proper precautions. At night, an attentive and practiced lookout man will always be able to see the blink of the ice at a fairly long distance. From the time when we had to reckon with any likelihood of meeting icebergs, the temperature of the water was also taken every 2 hours during the night. As Kerguelen Island lay almost directly in the course we intended to follow, it was decided for several reasons that we should call there and pay a visit to the Norwegian whaling section. Latterly, many of the dogs had begun to grow thin, and it seemed probable that this was owing to their not having enough fatty substances in their food. On Kerguelen Island, there would presumably be an opportunity of getting all the fat we wanted. As to water we had, it was true, just enough to last us with economy, but it would not do us harm to fill up the tanks. I was also hoping there would be a chance of engaging 3 or 4 extra hands. for the Fram would be rather short-handed with only 10 men to sail her out of ice and around the Horn to Buenos Aires after the rest of us had been landed on the barrier. Another reason for the contemplated visit was that it would be an agreeable diversion. We now only had to get there as quickly as possible, and the west wind helped us splendidly. One stiff breeze succeeded another without our having any excessive weather. Our daily distance at this time amounted, as a rule, to about 150 miles. In 124 hours, we made 174 miles. This was our best day's work of the whole voyage, and it had no better performance for a vessel like the Fram, with her limited sail area and her heavily laden hull. On the afternoon of November 28, we sighted land. It was only a barren rocky knoll, and according to our determination of the position, it would be the island called Bligh's Cap, which lies a few miles north of Kerguelen Island. But as the weather was not very clear, we were unacquainted with the channels. We preferred to lie to for the night before approaching any nearer. Early next morning, the weather was cleared, and we got accurate bearings. A course was laid for Royal Sound, where we supposed the whaling station to be situated. We were going well in the fresh morning breeze, and were just about to round the last headland, when all at once a gale sprang up. The bare and uninviting coast was hidden in heavy rain, and we had the choice of waiting for an indefinite time or continuing our voyage. Without much hesitation, we chose the latter alternative. It might be tempting enough to come in contact with other men, especially as they were fellow countrymen. But it was even more tempting to have done with the remaining 4,000 miles that lay between us and the barrier as quickly as possible. It turned out that we had chosen rightly. December brought us a fair wind, even fresher than that of November. By the middle of the month, we had already covered half the distance between Kerguelen Island and our goal. We fortified the dogs from time to time with a liberal allowance of butter, which had a marvelous effect. There was nothing wrong with ourselves. We were all in the best of health, and our spirits rose as we drew nearer our goal. That the state of our health was so remarkably good during the whole voyage must be ascribed in a material degree to the excellence of our provisions. During the trip from home to Madeira, we had lived sumptuously on some little pigs that we took with us, but after these luxuries we had to take to tinned meat for good. The change was not felt much, as we had excellent and palatable things with us. There was a separate service for the two cabins, but the food was precisely the same in each. Breakfast was at 8, consisting of American hot cakes with marmalade or jam, cheese, fresh bread, and coffee or cocoa. Dinner, as a rule, was composed of one dish of meat and sweets. As had already been said, we could not afford to have soup regularly on account of the water it required, and it was only served on Sundays. The second course usually consisted of Californian fruit. It was our aim all through to employ fruit, vegetables, and jam to the greatest possible extent. There is undoubtedly no better means of avoiding sickness. At dinner, we always drank syrup and water. Every Wednesday and Saturday, we were treated to a glass of spirits. I knew from my own experience how delicious a cup of coffee tastes when one turns out to go on watch at night. However sleepy and grumpy one may be, a gulp of hot coffee quickly makes a better man of one. Therefore, coffee for the night watch was a permanent institution on board the Fram. By about Christmas, we had reached nearly the 150th meridian in latitude 56 degrees south. This left not much more than 900 miles before we might expect to meet with the pack ice. A glorious west wind, which had driven us forward for weeks and freed us from all the anxiety about arriving too late, was now a thing of the past. For a change, we again had to contend for some days with calms and contrary wind. The day before Christmas Eve brought rain and a gale from the southwest, which was not very cheerful. If we were to keep Christmas with any festivity, fine weather was wanted. Otherwise, the everlasting rolling would spoil all our attempts. No doubt we should all have got over it if it had fallen to our lot to experience a Christmas Eve with the storm, shortened sail, and other delights. Worse things had happened before. On the other hand, there was not one of us who would not be the better for a little comfort and relaxation. Our life had been monotonous and commonplace enough for a long time, But as I said, the day before Christmas Eve was not all promising. The only sign of the approaching holiday was the fact that Lindstrom, in spite of the rolling, was busy baking Christmas cakes. We suggested that he might as well give us each our share at once, as it is well known that the cakes are the best when they come straight out of the oven. But Lindstrom would not hear of it. His cakes vanished for the time being under lock and key, and we had to be content with the smell of them. Christmas Eve arrived with fine weather and a smoother sea than we had seen for weeks. The ship was perfectly steady, and there was nothing to prevent our making every preparation for the festivity. As the day wore on, Christmas was in full swing. The fore cabin was washed and cleaned up until repellent paint and the brush shone with equal brilliance. Ron decorated the workroom with signal flags, and the good old Happy Christmas greeted us in a transparency over the door of the saloon. Inside, Nilsson was busily engaged, showing greater talents as a decorator. The gramophone was rigged up in my cabin on a board hung from the ceiling. The proposed concert of piano, violin, and mandolin had to be abandoned, as the piano was altogether out of tune. The various members of our little community appeared one after another, dressed and tidied up, so that many of them were scarcely recognizable. The stubbly chins were all smooth, and that makes a great difference. At 5 o'clock, the engine was stopped, and all the hands assembled on the fore cabin, leaving only the man at the wheel on the deck. Our cozy cabins had a fairy-like appearance in the subdued light of many colored lamps, and we were all in the Christmas humor at once. The decorations not honor to him who had carried them out, and to those who had given us the greater part of them. Mrs. Crower and the proprietor of Oyster Cellar at Christiania, Mr. Ditlev Hansen. Then we took our seats round the table, which groaned beneath Lindstrom's masterpieces in the culinary art. I slipped behind the curtain of my cabin for an instant and set the gramophone going. Harold sang us Glade Jewel. The song did not fail of its effect. It was difficult to see in the subdued light, but I fancy that among the band of hardy men that sat around the table, there was scarcely one who had not a tear in the corner of his eye. The thoughts of all took the same direction, I am certain. They flew homeward to the old country in the north, and we could wish nothing better than that those we had left behind should be as well off as ourselves. The melancholy feeling soon gave way to gaiety and laughter. In the course of the dinner, the first mate fired off a topical song written by himself, which had an immense success. In each verse, the little weakness of someone present were exhibited in more or less strong relief, and in between, there were marginal remarks in prose, both in text and performance. The author fully attained the object of his work, that of thoroughly exercising our risible muscles. In the after cabin, a well-furnished coffee table was set out, on which there was a large assortment of Lindstrom's Christmas baking, with a mighty Kranz cake from Hansen starring in the midst. While we were doing all possible honor to these luxuries, Lindstrom was busily engaged forward, and when we went back after our coffee, we found there a beautiful Christmas tree in all its glory. The tree was an artificial one, but so perfectly imitated that it might have come straight from the forest. This was also a present from Mrs. Crower. Then came the distribution of Christmas presents. Among the many kind friends who had thought of us, as I must mention, the ladies' committee in Horten and Friedstad and the telephone employees of Christiania. They all have a claim in our warmest gratitude for the share they had in making our Christmas what it was, a bright memory of the long voyage. By 10 o'clock in the evening, the candles of Christmas tree were burnt out, and the festivity was at an end. It had been successful from first to last, and we all had something to live on in our thoughts when our everyday duties again claimed us. In that part of the voyage which we now had before us, the region between Australian continent and the Antarctic belt of pack ice, we were prepared for all sorts of trials in the way of unfavorable weather conditions. We had read and heard so much of what others had to face in these waters that we involuntarily connected them with all the horrors that may befall a sailor. Not that we had a moment's fear for the ship, We knew her well enough to be sure that it would take some very extraordinary weather to do her any harm. If we were afraid of anything, it was of delay. But we were spared either delay or any other trouble. By noon on Christmas Day, we had just what was wanted to keep our spirits a festival pitch. A fresh northwesterly wind, just strong enough to push us along the handsomely toward our destination. It afterwards hauled a little more to the west and lasted the greater part of Christmas week until on December 30th we were in longitude 160 degree east and latitude 60 degree south. With that, we had at last come far enough to the east and could now begin to steer a southerly course. Hardly had we put the helm over, the wind changed to a stiff northerly breeze. Nothing could possibly be better. In this way, it would not take us long to dispose of the remaining degree of latitude. Our faithful companions of the westerly belt, the albatrosses, had now disappeared, and we could soon begin to look out for the representatives of the winged inhabitants of Antarctica. After a careful consideration of the experiences of our predecessors, it was decided to lay our course so that we should cross the 65th parallel in longitude 175 degree east. What we had to do was to get as quickly as possible through the belt of pack ice that blocked the way to the Ross Sea to the south of it, which is always open in summer. Some ships had been detained as much as 6 weeks in this belt of ice. Others had gone through in a few hours. We unhesitatingly preferred to follow the latter example, and therefore took the course that the luckier ones had indicated. Of course, the width of ice belt may be subject to somewhat fortuitous changes, but it seems nevertheless that as a rule, the region between the 175th and the 188 degrees of longitude offers the best chance of getting through rapidly. In any case, one ought not to enter the ice farther to the west. At noon on New Year's Eve, we were in latitude 62 degree 15 south. We had reached the end of Old Year, and really it had gone incredibly quickly. Like all its predecessors, the year had brought its share of successes and failure. But the main thing was that, at its close, we found ourselves pretty nearly where we ought to be to make our good calculations, and all safe and well. Conscious of this, we said goodbye to 1910 in all friendliness over a good glass of toddy in the evening, and wished each other all possible luck in 1911. At 3 in the morning of New Year's Day, the officer of the watch called me with news that the first iceberg was in sight. I had to go up and see it. Yes, there it lay, far to windward, shining like a castle in the rays of the morning sun. It was a big, flat-topped berg of the typical Antarctic form. It will perhaps seem paradoxical when I say that we all greeted this first sight of ice with satisfaction and joy. An iceberg is usually the last thing to gladden sailor's heart, but we were not looking at just the risk then. The meeting with the imposing colossus had another significance that had a stronger claim on our interest. The pack ice could not be far off. We were all longing as one man to be in it. It would be a grand variation in the monotonous life we had led for so long, and which we were beginning to be tired of. Merely to be able to run a few yards on an ice floe appeared to us as an event of importance, and we rejoiced no less at the prospect of giving our dogs a good meal of seal flesh, while we ourselves would have no objection to a little change of diet. The number of icebergs increased during the afternoon and night, and with such neighbors it suited us very well to have daylight all through 24 hours, as we now had. The weather could not have been better, fine and clear, with a light but still favorable wind. At 8 p.m. on 2nd January, the Antarctic Circle was crossed, and an hour or two later, the crow's nest was able to report the ice belt ahead. For the time being, it did not look like obstructing us to any greater extent. The floes were collected in long lines, with broad channels of open water between them. We steered right in. Our position was then longitude 176 degree east and latitude 60 degree 30 south. The ice immediately stopped all swell. The vessel's deck again became a stable platform, and after 2 months' incessant exercise of our sea legs, we could once more move about freely. That was a treat in itself. At 9 in the morning of the next day, we had our first opportunity of seal hunting. A big Weddell seal was observed on a floe right ahead. It took our approach with the utmost calmness, not thinking it was worthwhile to budge an inch until a couple of rifle bullets had it convinced of the seriousness of the situation. It then made an attempt to reach the water, but it was too late. Two men were already on the floe, and the valuable spoil was secured. In the course of a quarter of an hour, the beast lay on our deck, flayed and cut up by practiced hands. This gave us at one stroke at least 400 weight of dog food, as well as a good many rations for men. We made the same coup 3 times more in the course of the day, and thus had over a ton of fresh meat and blubber. It needed scarcely to be said that there was a great feast on board that day. The dogs did their utmost to avail themselves of the opportunity. They simply ate till their legs could carry no more of them, and we could grant them this gratification with a good conscience. As to ourselves, it may doubtless be taken for granted that we observed some degree of moderation, but dinner was polished off very quickly. Seal steak had many ardent adherents already, and it very soon gained more. Seal soup, in which our excellent vegetables showed to advantage, was perhaps even more favorably received. For the first 24 hours after we entered the ice, it was so loose that we were able to hold our course and keep up our speed for practically the whole time. On the two following days, things did not go quite so smoothly. At times, the lines of floes were fairly close, and occasionally we had to go round. We did not meet with any considerable obstruction, however. There were always openings enough to enable us to keep going. In the course of January 6th, a change took place. The floes became narrower and the leads broader. By 6 p.m., there was an open sea on every side as far as the eye could reach. The day's observations gave our position as latitude 70 degrees south and longitude 180 degrees east. Our passage through the pack had been a 4 days pleasure trip, and I have a suspicion that several among us looked back with secret regret to the cruise in smooth water through the ice floes when the swell of the open Ross Sea gave the Fram another chance of showing her rolling capabilities. But this last part of the voyage was also to be favoured by fortune. These comparatively little-known waters had no terrors to oppose us. The weather continued surprisingly fine. It could not have been better on a summer trip in the North Sea. Of icebergs, there was practically none. A few quite small floebergs were all we met in the 4 days we took to cross Ross Sea. About midday on Jan 11th, a marked brightening of the southern sky announced that it was not far to the goal we had been struggling to reach for 5 months. At 2:30 p.m., we came in sight of the Great Ice Barrier. Slowly, it rose up out of the sea until we were face to face with it in all its imposing majesty. It is difficult, with the help of a pen, to give any idea of the impression this mighty wall of ice makes on the observer who is confronted with it for the first time. It is altogether a thing which can hardly be described. But one can understand very well that this wall of 100 feet in height was regarded for a generation as an insuperable obstacle to further southward progress. We knew that the theory of barrier's impregnability had long ago been overthrown. There was an opening to the unknown realm beyond this. This opening, the Bay of Whales, ought to lie according to the description before us, about 100 miles to the east of the position in which we were. Our course was altered to true east, and during a cruise of 24 hours, along the barrier, we had every opportunity of marvelling this gigantic work of nature. It was not without a certain feeling of suspense that we looked forward to our arrival at the harbour we were seeking. What state should we find it in? Would it prove impossible to land at all, conveniently? One point after another was passed, but still our anxious eyes were met by nothing but the perpendicular wall. At last, on the afternoon of January 12th, the wall opened. This agreed with our expectations. We were now in longitude 164 degrees, the selfsame point where our predecessors had previously found access. We had before us a great bay, so deep that it was impossible to see the end of it from the crow's nest, but for the moment there was no chance of getting in. The bay was full of great floes, sea ice recently broken up. We therefore went on a little farther to the eastward to await developments. Next morning we returned, and after the lapse of a few hours, the floes within the bay began to move. One after another they came sailing out. The passage was soon free. As we steered up the bay, we soon saw clearly that here we had every chance of effecting a landing. All we had to do was to choose the best place. End of section 10, end of volume 1, chapter 4, From Madeira to the Barrier, part 2, recording by Naksha.
Section 11 of the South Pole. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recorded by Ken Campbell. The South Pole by Roald Amundsen. Translation by A.G. Carter. Section 11, Volume 1, Chapter 5. On the Barrier, Part 1. We had thus arrived on January 14th. A day earlier than we had reckoned at this vast, mysterious, natural phenomenon, the barrier. One of the most difficult problems of the expedition was solved, that of conveying our drought animals in sound condition to the field of operations. We had taken 97 dogs on board at Christiansen. The number had now increased to 116, and practically all of these would be fit to serve in the final march to the south. The next great problem that confronted us was to find a suitable place on the barrier for our station. My idea had been to get everything, equipment and provisions, conveyed far enough into the barrier to secure us against the unpleasant possibility of drifting out into the Pacific, in case the barrier should be inclined to clave. I had therefore fixed upon 10 miles as a suitable distance from the edge of the barrier, but even our first impression of the condition seemed to show that we should be spared a great part of this long and troublesome transport. Along its outer edge, the barrier shows an even, flat surface, but here, inside the bay, the conditions were entirely different. Even from the deck of the Fram, we were able to observe the great disturbances of the surface in every direction, huge ridges with hollows between them extending on all sides. The greatest elevation lay to the south in the form of a lofty, arched ridge, which we took to be about 500 feet high on the horizon, but it must be assumed that this ridge continued to rise beyond the range of vision. Our original hypothesis that this bay was due to the underlying land seemed therefore to be immediately confirmed. It did not take long to moor the vessel to the fixed ice foot, which here extended for about a mile and a quarter beyond the edge of the barrier. Everything had been got ready long before. Bjaaland had put our ski in order, and every man had his right pairs fitted. Ski boots had long ago been tried on, time after time, sometimes with one, sometimes with two pairs of stockings. Of course, it turned out that the ski boots were on the small side. To get a bootmaker to make a roomy boot is, I believe, an absolute impossibility. However, with two pairs of stockings, we could always get along in the neighborhood of the ship. For longer journeys, we had canvas boots, as already mentioned. On the remainder of the outfit, I need only mention the alpine ropes, which had also been ready for some time. They were about 30 yards long and were made of very fine rope, soft as silk, specially suited for the use in low temperatures. After a hurried dinner, four of us set out. The first excursion was quite a solemn affair, so much depended on it. The weather was of the very best, calm with brilliant sunshine, and a few light feathery clouds in the beautiful pale blue sky. There was warmth in the air, which could be felt even on this immense ice field. Seals were lying around the ice foot as far as the eye could reach, great fat mountains of flesh, food enough to last us and the dogs for years. The going was ideal. Our ski glided easily and pleasantly through the newly fallen loose snow. But none of us was exactly in training after the long 5-month sea voyage, so that the pace was not great. After half an hour's march, we were already at the first important point, the connection between the sea ice and the barrier. This connection had always haunted our brains. What would it be like? A high, perpendicular face of ice, up which we should have to haul our things laboriously with the help of tackles? Or a great and dangerous fissure, which we should not be able to cross without going a long way round. We naturally expected something of the sort. This mighty and terrible monster would, of course, offer resistance in some form or another. The Mystic Barrier. All accounts without exception, from the days of Ross to the present time, had spoken of this remarkable natural formation with apprehensive awe. It was as though one could always read between the lines the same sentence. Hush, be quiet. The Mystic Barrier. 1, 2, 3, and a little jump, and the barrier was surmounted. We looked at each other and smiled. Probably the same thought was in the minds of all of us. The monster had begun to lose something of its mystery. The terror, something of its force, the incomprehensible, was becoming quite easy to understand. Without striking a blow, we had entered into our kingdom. The barrier was at this spot about 20 feet high, and the junction between it and the sea ice was completely filled up with driven snow, so that the ascent took the form of a little gentle slope. This spot would certainly offer us no resistance. Hitherto we had made our advance without a rope. The sea ice, we knew, would offer no hidden difficulties, but what would be the condition of the things beyond the barrier was another question. And as we all thought it would be better to have the ropes on before we fell into a crevice than afterwards, our further advance was made with a rope between the first two. We proceeded in an easterly direction up through the little valley formed by Mount Nelson on one side and Mount Ronniken on the other. The reader must not, however, imagine from these imposing names that we were walking between any formidable mountain ranges. Mount Nelson and Ronniken were nothing but two old pressure ridges that had been formed in those far-off days when the mighty mass of ice had pushed on with awful force without meeting hindrance or resistance, until at this spot it met a superior power that clove and splintered it and set a bound to its further advance. It must have been a frightful collision, like the end of the world. But now it was over. Peace. An air of infinite peace lay over it all. Nelson and Ronniken were only two pensioned veterans. Regarded as pressure ridges, they were huge, raising their highest summits over 100 feet in the air. Here, in the valley, the surface round Nelson was quite filled up, while Ronniken still showed a deep scar, a fissure, or hollow. We approached cautiously. It was not easy to see how deep it was, and whether it had an invisible connection with Nelson or the other side of the valley. But this was not the case. On a closer examination, this deep cleft proved to have a solid, filled-up bottom. Between the ridges, the surface was perfectly flat and offered an excellent site for a dog camp. Captain Nielsen and I had worked out a kind of program of the work to be done, and in this it was decided that the dog should be brought on the barrier as quickly as possible, and there looked after by two men. We chose this place for the purpose. The old pressure ridges told the history of the spot plainly enough. We had no need to fear any kind of disturbance here. The site had the additional advantage that we could see the ship from it, and would always be in communication with those on board. From here the valley turned slightly to the south. After having marked the spot where our first tent was to be set up, we continued our investigations. The valley sloped gradually upwards and reached the ridge at a height of 100 feet. From this elevation we had an excellent view over the valley we had been following, and all the other surroundings. On the north the barrier extended, level and straight, apparently without interruption, and ended on the west in a steep descent of Cape Man's Head, which formed the eastern limit of the inner part of the Bay of Whales, and afforded a snug little corner where we had found room for our ship. There lay the whole of the inner part of the bay, bounded on all sides by ice. Ice, nothing but ice barrier, as far as we could see, white and blue. This spot, no doubt, would show a surprising play of color later on, and it promised well in this way. The ridge we were standing on was not broad, about 200 yards, I think, and in many places it was swept quite bare by the wind, showing the blue ice itself. We passed over it and made for the pass of Thermopile, which extended in a southerly direction from the ridge, and after a very slight descent was merged in the great plain, surrounded by elevations on all sides, a basin, in fact. The bare ridge we passed over to descend into the basin was a good deal broken up, but the fissures were narrow and almost entirely filled up again with drift, so that they were not dangerous. The basin gave us the impression of being sheltered and cozy, and above all, it looked safe and secure. This stretch of ice was, with the exception of a few quite small hummocks of the shape of haycocks, perfectly flat and free from crevices. We crossed it and went up on the ridge that rose very gently on the south. From the top of this all was flat and even as far as we could see, but that was not saying much. For a little while we continued along the ridge in an easterly direction without finding any place that was specially suited for our purpose. Our thoughts returned to the basin as the best sheltered place we had seen. From the height we were now on, we could look down onto the southeastern part of the Bay of Whales. In contrast to that part of the ice foot to which we had made fast, the inner bay seemed to consist of ice that had been forced up by pressure. But we had to leave a closer examination of this part till later. We all liked the basin and agreed to choose it as our future abode. And so we turned and went back again. It did not take long to reach the plain in our own tracks. After making a thorough examination of the surface and discussing the various possibilities, we came to the conclusion that a site for the hut was to be looked for on the little elevation that rose to the east. It seemed that we should be more snug there than anywhere else, and we were not mistaken. We soon made up our minds that we had chosen the best place the barrier had to offer. On the spot where the hut was to stand, we set up another ski pole and then went home. The good news that we had already found a favorable place for the hut naturally caused great satisfaction on all sides. Everyone had been silently dreading the long and troublesome transport over the ice barrier. There was teeming life on the ice. Whenever we turned, we saw great herds of seals, Wendells, and crab-eaters. The great sea leopard, which we had seen occasionally on the floes, was not to be found here. During our whole stay in the Bay of Whales, we did not see a single specimen of it, nor did we ever see the Ross seal. Penguins had not shown themselves particularly often, only a few here and there, but we appreciated them all the more. The few we saw were almost all Adelie penguins. While we were at work making the ship fast, a flock of them suddenly shot up out of the water and onto the ice. They looked about them in surprise for a moment. Men and ships do not come their way every day. But it seemed as if their astonishment soon gave way to a desire to see what was happening. They positively sat and studied all of our movements. Only now and then they grunted a little and took a turn over the ice. What specifically interested them was evidently our work at digging holes in the snow for grapnels. They flocked about the men who were engaged in this, laid their heads on one side, and looked as if they had found it immensely interesting. They did not appear to be the least afraid of us, and for the most part we left them in peace. But some of them had to lose their lives. We wanted them for our collection. An exciting seal hunt took place the same day. Three crab-eaters had ventured to approach the ship and were marked down to increase our store of fresh meat. We picked two mighty hunters to secure the prey for us. They approached with the greatest caution, though this was altogether unnecessary, for the seals lay perfectly motionless. They crept forward in Indian fashion with their heads down and their backs bent. This looked fine. I chuckled, a laugh, but still with a certain decorum. Then there is a report. Two of the sleeping seals gave a little spasm and do not move again. It is otherwise with the third. With snake-like movements, it wiggled away through the loose snow with surprising speed. It is no longer target practice, but hunting real game. And the result is keeping with it. Bang, bang, and bang again. It is a good thing we had plenty of ammunition. One of the hunters uses up all of his cartridges and has to go back, but the others set off in pursuit of the game. Oh, how I laughed. Decorum was no longer possible. I simply shook with laughter. Away they went through the loose snow, the seal first and the hunter after. I could see by the movements of the pursuer that he was furious. He saw that he was in for something which he could not come out of with dignity. The seal made off with such a pace that it filled the air with snow. Although the snow was fairly deep and loose, the seal kept on the surface. Not so the hunter. He sank over his knees at every step, and in a short time was completely outdistanced. From time to time he halted, aimed, and fired. He himself afterwards asserted that every shot had hit. I had my doubts. In any case, the seal seemed to take no notice of them, for it went on with undiminished speed. At last the mighty man gave up and turned back. "Beastly hard to kill," I heard him say as he came on board. I suppressed a smile, did not want to hurt the fellow's feelings. What an evening! The sun is high in the heavens in spite of the late hour. Over all this mountainous land of ice, over the mighty barrier running south, there lies a bright white shining light, so intense that it dazzles the eyes. But northward lies the night, leaden gray upon the sea. It passes into deep blue as the eye is raised and pales by degrees until it is swallowed up in the radiant gleam from the barrier. What lies behind the night? That smoke-black mass, we know. That part we have explored and have come off victorious. But what does the dazzling day to the south conceal? Inviting and attractive, the fair one lies before us. Yes, we hear you calling, and we shall come. You shall have your kiss, if we pay for it with our lives. The following day, Sunday, brought the same fine weather. Of course, there could be no thoughts of Sunday for us. Not one of us would have cared to spend the day in idleness. We were now divided into two parties, the sea party and the land party. The sea party, 10 men, took over the Fram, while on this day the land party took up their abode on the barrier for a year or two, or whatever it might be. The sea party was comprised of Nielsen, Gertsen, Beck, and Sundbeck, Ludvig Hansen, Christensen, Ronnie, Notvedt, Kutzen, and Olsen. The land party consisted of Prestud, Johansen, Helmer Hansen, Hansel, Bjarland, Stubervund, Lindstrom, and myself. Lindstrom was to stay on board for a few days longer, as we still had to take most of our meals on the ship. The plan was that one party, composed of 6 men, should camp in a 16-man tent in the space between Ronneken and Nelson, while another party of 2 were to live in a tent up at the butt site and build the hut. The last 2 were, of course, our capable carpenters, Bjarland and Stubberud. By 11 o'clock in the morning, we were at least ready to start. We had 1 sledge, 8 dogs, and provisions and equipment weighing altogether 660 pounds. It was my team that was to open the ball. The sea party had all collected on deck to witness the first start. All was now ready. After countless efforts on our part, or if it is preferred, after a thorough thrashing for every dog, we had at last got them in a line before the sledge in Alaska harness. With a flourish and a crack of the whip, we set off. I glanced at the ship. Yes, as I thought, all of our comrades were standing in a row admiring the fine start. I am not quite sure that I did not hold my head rather high and look around with a certain air of triumph. If I did so, it was foolish of me. I ought to have waited. The defeat would have been easier to bear. For defeat it was, and a signal one. The dogs had spent half a year in lying about and eating and drinking, and had got the impression that they would never have anything else to do. Not one of them appeared to understand that a new era of toil had begun. After moving forward a few yards, they all sat down as though at a word of command and stared at each other. The most undisguised astonishment could be read in their faces. When, at last, we had succeeded with another dose of the whip in making them understand that we really asked them to work, instead of doing as they were told, they flew at each other in a furious scrimmage. Heaven help me! What work we had with those 8 dogs that day! If it was going to be like this on the way to the pole, I calculated in the midst of the tumult that it would take exactly a year to get there, without counting the return journey. During all this confusion, I stole another glance at the ship, but the sight that met me made me quickly withdraw my eyes again. They were simply shrieking with laughter, and loud shouts of the most infamous encouragement reached us. "If you go on like that, you'll get there by Christmas," or "Well done, stick to it, now you're off." We were stuck faster than ever. Things looked desperate. At last, with the combined strength of all animals and men, we got the sledge to move again. So our first sledge trip could not be called a triumph. We then set up our first tent on the barrier between Mounts Nelson and Rönniken, a large, strong tent for 16 men, with the sheet for the floor sewed on. Round the tent wire ropes were stretched in a triangle, 50 yards on each side. To these the dogs were to be tethered. The tent was furnished with 5 sleeping bags and a quantity of provisions. The distance we had come was 1.2 geographical miles, or 2.2 kilometers, measured by the sledge meter. After finishing this work, we went up on the site selected for the station. Here we set up the tent, a similar tent to the others, for 16 men, for the use of the carpenters, and marked out the hut site. According to the lay of the ground, we elected to make the house face east and west, not north and south, as one might have been tempted to do, since it was usually supposed that the most frequent and violent storms came from the south. We chose rightly. The prevailing wind was from the east, and thus caught our house on the most protected short wall. The door faced west. When this work was done, we marked out the way from here to the encampment below, and thence to the vessel, with dark flags at every 15 paces. In this way we should be able to drive with certainty from one place to another without losing time if a storm should set in. The distance from the hut to the vessel was 2.2 geographical miles, or 4 kilometers. On Monday, January 16th, work began in earnest. About 80 dogs, 6 teams, drove up to the first encampment with all the provisions and equipment that could be loaded on the sledges, and 20 dogs. Stubberun's and Bjaaland's teams went with a full load up to the other camp. We had some work indeed those first days to get the dogs to obey us. Time after time they tried to take the command from their masters and steer their own course. More than once it cost us a wet shirt to convince them that we were really the masters. It was strenuous work, but it succeeded in the end. Poor dogs. They got plenty of thrashing in those days. Our hours were long. We seldom turned in before 11 at night, and we were up again at 5. But it did not seem particularly hard. We were all alike, eager for the work to be finished as soon as possible, so that the Fram might get away. The harbor arrangements were not of the best. The quay she was moored to suddenly broke into pieces, and all hands had to turn out to make her fast to a new quay. Perhaps they had just got to sleep again when the same operation had to be repeated, for the ice broke time after time and kept the unfortunate sea rovers in constant activity. It is enervating work, being always at one post and sleeping with one eye open. They had a hard time to contend with, our 10 comrades, and the calm way in which they took everything was extraordinary. They were always in good humor and always had a joke ready. It was the duty of the sea party to bring up all the provisions and outfit for the wintering party from the hold and put them on the ice. Then the land party removed them. This work proceeded very smoothly, and it was rare that one party had to wait for the other. During the first few days of sledging, all the members of the land party became quite hoarse, some of them so badly that they almost lost their voices. This came from the continual yelling and shouting that we had to do at first to make the dogs go, but this gave the sea party a welcome opportunity of finding us a nickname. We were called the Chatterers. Apart from the unpleasantness of constantly changing the anchorage on account of the breaking up and drifting out of the ice, the harbor must in other respects been regarded as very good. A little swell might set in from time to time and cause some disagreeable bumping, but never anything to embarrass the vessel. One very great advantage was that the currents in this corner always set outward, and thus kept off all icebergs. The sledging between the ship and the barrier was done by 5 men to begin with, as the carpenters were engaged in building the house. One man had also been told off as tent guard, for we could not use more than half our teams, 6 dogs at a time. If we harnessed a full team of 12, we only had trouble and fights. The dogs which were thus left behind had to be looked after, and a man was required for this duty. Another of the duties of the tent guard was to cook the day's food and keep the tent tidy. It was a coveted position, and lots were cast for it. It gave a little variety in the continual sledging. End of section 11. Record.